Shalom, shalom. First and foremost, I want to give all praises, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bashem, Yahweh Shah, Bashem, Rakah Kodash, double honors to the apostles, elders, and great millstone, the men that taught us this truth through the Spirit. All right. Peace and blessings to you, brothers, teaching this word, the truth, and sincerity. Now, it's the brother Barak Abar, and I got with me.
I'm Noah Allah.
And this is a response to second round of the Virgin Birth with GMS.
This is an old video.
Yeah. This is a throwback. All right. But the topic is still relevant, and this is something that got to be covered. Mm-hmm. A stronghold that got to be pulled down, like exactly. The scriptures say. You know, another vain imagination and every word that exalts of itself against the Most High, because the virgin birth isn't biblical.
Exactly.
All right.
And what made us want to get into this, because we got this dude, Abu. Mm-hmm. We're talking about, what is it that he was saying?
Basically, he's saying that the Lashawan Kodash basically is not real. Or anything that we believe in, according to the Bible, isn't real.
Right.
But their interpretation and their theologian schools, it all got it right.
Exactly. So basically what we're doing here, since this topic of this Abu guy came up, which Vocab Malone had put that video up on his page, right?
Yeah.
The spirit jumped on me because he was thinking about the page. Mm-hmm. He was thinking about his real page. I was like, if I'm not mistaken, that's that truth after knowledge cat.
Right, right.
So he was having truth after knowledge, went on his page, and we started going to the virgin birth, and bro, let you know, let's just do a lesson.
Yeah.
So here we are.
Yeah. So we're going to play the video and
rebuttal. The beginning?
Nah, ain't got to go to the beginning.
Okay.
We're going to play the video and do our commentary through the spirit of power, Yahweh, Bashem, Yahweh Shah.
Talking about the end of the world. That's what you're supposed to be talking about. You got guys coming on the site talking about Mary, isn't she the virgin? Nigga, we at the end of this thing, man.
For those that don't know, Truth After Knowledge, this is a YouTube channel where this is going back 10 years, yeah. Probably even more years.
Yeah.
And just every video, every topic that the apostles and any member of GMS, brother GMS ever dealt with, this is basically like a whole channel, like a whole channel dedicated to debunking the truth.
Right.
But you can't debunk the truth.
Right.
You know?
You should have been done that a long time ago, man. You should have got it a long time ago. We're at the end of it, stuck on you. That's 10-year-old stuff, man. What's the mind that you're supposed to be in, man? Not talking about whether Mary, that's, like I said, that's 10 years ago stuff. That's old stuff. That, you should have been had that.
In other words, what the apostles are saying is, that guy should have been got that Yahweh Shah was not born of a virgin birth. Mm-hmm. That should have been understood that.
Right.
This is 10 years ago. So in other words, this is stuff that people couldn't get 10 years ago.
Right.
This stuff that was that we delved deep into 10 years ago.
Right.
You should have already got it by now.
Right.
It's that simple. Oh, right. But he said something a week prior.
Right.
So what? That don't mean he can't ever speak on it.
Right.
That's something you should have been got. Like, people should have been got according to the Bible. The Lord is in a so-called white man.
Exactly.
Does that mean we're going to be out in the streets and never talk about how he's actually a so-called black man?
Right.
Come on now, man.
You take things literal.
That's these meticulous people, man. They got to do every single little thing. Oh, look how he moved his hand.
Right.
Oh, look how he wear that garment.
Right. Straining out a net.
Straining out a net.
When he said on his mother's breast, that was his actual mother, and she had sex with Joseph.
Right.
See that BS, that bullshit that they teach in the Roman Catholic Church, that she was a virgin, immaculate conception, that's all BS.
That's right.
Let me say it in plain English. That's all bullshit, all right? And for any so-called Roman Catholic priest that want to debate us, all you got to do is come on Great Millstone on YouTube and just drop us a line and we'll get together and we'll see how much you know about the scripture.
We'll be right back. don't mean that the apostle can't pose a question.
Right.
That don't mean he can't pose a question. A question is being posed about something that you should already got. Because it's amazing how you got guys out there that still lost. Like, you got guys that still think the mark of the beast is not the RFID chip.
Right.
That's something guys should have been got 10 plus years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you want to debate about it, we're saying the same thing that Apostle Hall said. If you want to debate about it, come on comment boards. Do response videos.
Prove us wrong.
And then when you make your response videos, what exactly we're going to say, you're going to be like, see, you got guys that still can't get it.
Exactly.
It's like what the Apostle Hall is saying. This is just a testament of how people can't understand anything.
Mm-hmm.
The angel Gabriel put the seed of the Holy Spirit in him, where it says he is the root and offspring. Show me where the angel Gabriel came out of the line of Judah.
Or had sex with Mary. Angels don't have sperm.
Angels don't have sperm.
They don't have seed.
Go ahead.
For verily he took not on him the nature of angels.
That's talking about the Lord. Verily he took. But hold up. He's supposed to be a son of the angel, right?
Right.
They make movies on that, right?
They got this Hollywood.
Exactly.
That's why you bring that up. People actually do say that.
Mm-hmm.
Gabriel did.
Right.
That people. Some people actually believe that.
Right. They actually believe the Hollywood version. Of who the world ignorantly called Jesus Christ. An angel came and they impregnate Mary, and this where this whole virgin birth lie came from.
That's right.
Conception of Jesus Christ. Like he was an angel. And here the brothers reading, he took not on the nature of angels. Yep, it is right there.
That's right.
Can't
that's
get
right.
around that.
That's right.
You that believe Jesus Christ had an angelic nature, you should learn how to read.
Yeah.
Or you should learn.
First of all, how are you gonna put an angel on the cross?
Right.
But you know that virgin birth all goes back to ancient Babylon.
Right.
Semiramis,
Tammuz,
Nimrod.
Right.
And the Roman Catholic Church, being a pagan organization.
Right.
Adopted pagan customs.
Right.
You know? And they take those pagan customs and they try to mask it with the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But you can't do that.
If he's an angel, he's half angel.
The Lord Stephen said, spirit hath not flesh and blood as you see me have.
Right.
Says Matthew 18 makes it. It says Matthew 18. Matthew 18 makes it clear that Mary was pregnant before she was in physical union with Joseph, but that's not what it's talking about. We're gonna break that down. Tahar offers up. It says Tahar, the apostle Tahar, but he referenced him as Tahar. It says offers up his own private interpretation, claiming that before the canon gathering only mean before they had a wedding feast, which that's it. Which that is what we're talking about.
Right.
You know, so let's get right to it. Got a regular blue.
Matthew's 1:18. Now the birth of Yahweh Shah Mashiach was on this wise.
So the birth of Yahweh Shah was on this wise. This is how it went down. Mm-hmm. This is how it happened.
When, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph.
Right, she was espoused to Joseph. The word espoused is the word up in the Greek. It means she was promised unto him.
Mm-hmm.
So Mary was espoused to Joseph. She was promised unto Joseph.
Right.
Go ahead.
before they came together.
Right, before they came together. Mm-hmm. So he's saying that before they came together clearly means before there was a physical union between Mary and Joseph.
Right.
Between Joseph and Mary. Meaning before Joseph and Mary actually had the physical act of sex. Mm-hmm. That's not what that's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, can you look that word up? Was that together?
Together. What's that? Sin?
You can't press it?
Nah, my audio don't pop up.
Okay. Let me see if I can get it on my phone. Give me 1 second. All right, so let's see what that word did for
together.
Together is come together in Matthew 1:18.
Strong's G 4905. Sunerchamai.
Sunerchamai. It says to come together, to assemble, of conjugal cohabitation,
mm-hmm.
to go, to part, or come with one, to accompany one. Mm-hmm. So it means to accompany, and it means assemble. Come together and it says conjugal cohabitation.
Mm-hmm.
Now we gotta see, what does it mean by conjugal? What does that mean? You know, because conjugal has many definitions.
Right.
Now it says definition of conjugal, of or relating to the married state or to married persons and their relations, married people's relations.
Right.
Okay. Of or relating to the married state or to married persons and their relations. Now, in prison, they got something called conjugal visits.
Right.
Where if a person is, like, legally married to someone, they could have sex with them.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not just what conjugal is.
Right.
Conjugal deals with relating to a married state or married persons and their relations.
Mm-hmm.
How they conduct themselves among one another.
Right.
The duties of a husband, the duties of a wife, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. So, don't necessarily have to have something to do with sex.
You're right.
Which he's trying to make a reference, because if he's correct, which he isn't correct, then that therefore means he could say, well, it means that they actually didn't have sex then.
Mm-hmm.
Because it said before they came together, before they had a physical union.
Before they had sex.
Well, right. The word, look at the word up in the Greek, it says conjugal cohabitation.
Mm-hmm.
Conjugal meaning of or related, means unrelated to the married state of married persons and their relations.
Mm-hmm.
So all things that relate to a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Which sex could be a part of a marriage, we understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But there are also other things like a feast, a wedding.
A ceremony,
which would actually occur. And which you'll understand when we get further on into the breakdown of the scripture.
Right.
And anything you want to chime in?
Yeah. I want to look up this word, cohabitation.
Yep.
Cohabitation is an arrangement where two people are not married but live together. They are often involved in romantic or sexually intimate relationships or long-term permanent basis. So they was together. They mm-hmm. was together. But like the brother was going into, this is before this the actual wedding ceremony or wedding feast. So let's get back to the scripture.
Exactly. Go ahead.
It says, now the birth of Yahushua Mashiach was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together.
Right, was espoused to Joseph before they came together, meaning before they had conjugal cohabitation,
mm-hmm.
which where conjugal goes to the state of married state or married person's relations.
Right.
Okay, which does not necessarily have to mean sex. Cohabitation, like the brother went to the definition of cohabitation, like when you were living with somebody. But in this particular scripture, where it says before they come together, it's talking about before they actually had that particular feast, before they actually conducted those particular marriage relations in
right.
regards to a ceremony. And we know that because we can go into the scripture to prove that.
She was found with child.
So first, let's go to Genesis 29th chapter. Let's go to Genesis 29th chapter. You know? Because they're trying to say, oh, before they come together means before they actually had sex with one another.
29 and what?
29 and 21.
Book of Genesis chapter 29 verse 21. And Jacob said unto Laban, give me my wife.
Yeah, Jacob said unto Laban, give me my wife. Because she was promised unto him.
Right.
And he's talking about, go ahead.
Give me my wife. for my days are fulfilled, that I may go in unto her. And Laban gathered together all the men of this place and made a feast. And it came to pass.
But you know he worked 7 years for Rachel.
Right.
But he was given Leah. So it said, he said, give me my wife for my days are fulfilled that I may go in unto her. That he may go unto her and do what? Mm-hmm. Have sex with her. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
And Laban gathered together all the men of the palace of the place and made a feast.
And they had a feast. Okay. This is before they came together.
Right.
Before he went unto her, right?
Right.
They had a feast.
Right.
How we know that? Keep reading.
And it came to pass in the evening that he took Leah, his daughter, and brought her to him, and he went in unto her.
And he went in unto her.
Right.
He went in unto her. But in this particular instance, he went unto her after they had the feast.
After the feast.
So when it comes to Joseph and Mary, mm-hmm. he went unto her before that happened.
Before the feast.
That's why when you read, it says before in Matthew 1:18, it says before they came together. It means mm-hmm. before they had the feast.
Right.
Because before the man would have sex with that woman, they would normally have a wedding feast. Mm-hmm. And how do we know this? We going back to the customs of our ancestors mm-hmm. in Genesis 29th chapter, how Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife, that I may go in unto her.
Right.
And what happened was they had a wedding feast, and then he went unto her.
Then he went unto her.
Okay? So that's how it was actually supposed to have been done.
Right.
In the time of Joseph and Mary. Mm-hmm. But that's not what happened. He did it before they came together. Mm-hmm. He did it before the feast.
Mm-hmm. It says, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit.
Wait a minute.
So before that. Like the brothers building on. Before, because Laban he said, give me my wife. How did he give her?
Jacob said that.
Yeah, how did Jacob said, give me my wife. How did Laban give Jacob his wife? Through the feast. Mm-hmm. That's the custom, like the brother said. That was the custom. And then he laid on to her. So we understand. We understand the terminology is in reference to feast or the ceremony.
And notice it's like, give me my wife that I may go in unto her.
Right.
Because that's what she was promised to him, but that's what ultimately would make her his wife, him going unto her.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Go ahead.
So it says, she was found with the child of the Holy Ghost or Spirit.
Right. She was found with the child. Before they came together, she was found with the child of the Holy Spirit. So what does it mean she was found with the child of the Holy Spirit? Does it mean that something just, the Most High just instantly got her pregnant?
Right.
No, it's not talking about that. Mm-hmm. Now, if you go to the book of John 6:63, the scripture says, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Mm-hmm. So it says she was found with child of the Holy Spirit, meaning she was found of the child that was of the prophecy that was written in the scripture. Mm-hmm. In Isaiah the 7th chapter and the 14th verse.
Right.
That's the reason why when you read Matthew's, the first chapter, when you read Matthew, the first chapter, it references Isaiah. In the 23rd verse, it references Isaiah the 7th chapter. Mm-hmm. So it said before they came together, meaning before they had the feast, because that was the custom, as of going back to Genesis, the 29th chapter, before they came together, but they didn't have the feast. So before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit, meaning before the actual wedding feast, she was already pregnant with the child of the Holy Spirit. Or the child, the Spirit represents what? The Word. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Mm-hmm. So she was found with child of the Holy Spirit, meaning she was found with the child of the prophecy that was written of her in the book of Isaiah, the 7th chapter and the 14th verse, that a virgin was going to conceive. Mm-hmm. That's what it's talking about.
Right.
Because guess what? John the Baptist was
born in the Holy Spirit. Spirit.
Right. Does it mean that Elizabeth didn't have sex with Zacharias?
Zacharias, yeah.
Come on, man.
Right.
It's not talking about that.
So obviously it's not talking about a virgin birth.
So obviously it's not talking about a virgin birth. Mm-hmm. It's not talking about that. But this is just the beginning.
Yeah. So it said, let's continue the video.
Yeah. Yeah, we almost went too far.
Hey.
Was minded to put her away privately.
What does that mean? Hide her.
Hide her.
Don't let her be seen too much. Go ahead.
says Tahar is confusing himself in the vagueness of the English translation. The Greek text has aplousai, which is from a verb meaning set free, dismiss, depart from, send away, release, and even divorce. Joseph was not merely hiding Mary, he was ending it. Now let's look that up.
This guy's an imbecile. Oh man. No. And what scripture is that?
Matthew's 1:19. Let's read that.
Okay. See if I can get the Greek word up here.
It says, then Joseph, her husband. Hold on, let's touch on this line by line.
Yeah. Let's deal with that right there.
Matthew chapter 1, verse 19. Then Joseph, her husband. So this is confirming that Joseph is already her husband. It ain't saying her spouse, her soon-to-be. This is confirming that she's already married to this man.
Exactly. Because they had sex. Keeping my wife that I may go in unto her.
Mm-hmm.
Because ultimately going unto that woman is what makes her your wife. Makes her your woman.
Mm-hmm. This is,
That's why in the book of Genesis 4:1, it says that Adam knew Eve, his wife. Cain knew his wife in Genesis 4th chapter as well.
Mm-hmm. This is Strong G435. Anur. It says reference to sex of a male, of a husband, of a betrothed or future husband.
What's that, Matthew what?
1:19.
What word is that?
Husband.
Okay.
With reference to age, a distinguished adult man from a boy, any male, used generically of a group of both men and women. So it says of with reference to sex. So let's put that in there. Then Joseph, her sex partner, you know, being a just man and not willing
because
to...
Because that's what will make her his husband.
Right.
That's what make her, him... That will make him... Her husband.
Right.
Okay. So it says, then Joseph, her husband. Joseph, her husband, who she was having sex with.
Right. Being a just man. Yeah,
Joseph being her husband, who she had sex with, being a just man.
Mm-hmm. And not willing to make her public, a public example, was minded to put her away privily.
Now, wait a minute now. It says, then Joseph, her husband, being the just man. And not willing to make her a public example.
Mm-hmm.
Now we gotta go to, what's that, Genesis 22nd chapter? Not Genesis, Deuteronomy 22nd chapter. It says he was not willing to make her a public example.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to do it, we have to understand, what is a public example?
Right.
Okay? What would make Mary be looked at as being a public example? Because it says he was a just man. So she was already pregnant before they came together. They already had sex with each other before there was a wedding feast.
Mm-hmm.
But Joseph, being just man, who was her husband, he didn't want to make her a public example. So what we got to do is we got to find out, why didn't he want to make her a public example?
Mm-hmm.
What could have been the result of Mary being looked at as a public example? It says Deuteronomy 22 and 16. 22 and... 22 and 13.
Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 13. If any man take a wife and go in unto her and hate her and give occasion of speech against her and bring up an evil name upon her and say, I took this woman, and when I came to her, I found her not a maid, then shall the father of the damsel and her mother...
So if a man had a woman that he was... Read that verse again, I'm sorry, brother.
Mm-hmm. Verse 13, Deuteronomy 22 and 13. If a man take a wife and go in unto her and hate her and give occasion of speech against her and bring up an evil name upon her.
So if a man has a wife, he go in unto her, he has sex with her, and he hates her, he bring up evil speech, he brings up, he give occasion to speak a speech against her mm-hmm. and bring up an evil name upon her mm-hmm. and say what?
And say, I took this woman, and when I came to her, I found her not a maid.
So if this man took him to have a wife and had sex with this woman, and he brought up an evil name against her, an accusation against her, saying, I took this woman, I found her not a maid.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning, I took this woman was not a virgin. I was having sex with this woman, she wasn't a virgin.
Right.
Would you therefore make that woman an adulteress?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Go ahead.
Then shall the father of the damsel and her mother take and bring forth the tokens of the damsel's virginity unto the elders of the city in the gate.
Because in the ancient world, when that man would go into that woman, or go into the nuptial chambers, mm-hmm. there would be a cloth that they would have laid down on, and he would have sex with that woman.
Mm-hmm.
And when that man would penetrate that woman, that blood from the woman was supposed to go upon that cloth, and it was supposed to be looked at as a token of her virginity.
Right.
So the damsel's parents would have to bring the tokens of her virginity, proving that this woman was actually a virgin. But there would be something that would happen if the woman wasn't found a virgin. Go ahead.
And the damsel's father shall say unto the elders, I gave my daughter unto this man to wife, and he hateth her. And lo, he have given occasion of speech against her, saying, I found not thy daughter a maid, meaning a virgin,
mm-hmm.
and yet these are the tokens of my daughter's virginity, meaning the blood on the sheets,
mm-hmm.
and they shall spread the cloth before the elders of the city. And the elders of the city shall take that man and chastise him, and they shall immerse him in 100 shekels of silver, and give unto the father of the damsel, because he have brought up an evil name upon the virgin of Israel, and she shall be his wife. He may not put her away all his days.
So that's if a man brought up a false accusation against mm-hmm. her. But let's keep going.
But if this thing be true.
But if it be true, if it be actually true, that she wasn't a virgin,
mm-hmm.
well, what happened?
And the tokens of virginity be not found.
There's no tokens of virginity.
Mm-hmm. No bloody sheets. And the tokens of her virginity be not found for the damsel, then they shall bring out the damsel to the door of her father's house, and the men of her city shall stone her with stones that she die.
So if it was proven that this woman, and that word there for maid, when you look it up, is in Deuteronomy 22:14, it's Bathwalam.
Mm-hmm.
When you look it up, which means a woman who's actually a virgin.
Mm-hmm.
So if it was found out that this woman wasn't a virgin, what happened was they was going to bring her to the door of her father's house, and the men in the city was going to stone her with stones that she died. That's what was going to happen.
Because she have wrought folly in Israel to play the whore in her father's house.
Exactly. She brought folly in Israel to play whore in her father's house, which therefore means that she played whore in her father's house. That would have to mean that she was involved with another man.
So shalt thou put evil away from among you.
So shalt thou put evil away from among you. So that woman was supposed to be put to death before the public. As mm-hmm. a matter of fact, can you go back to Matthew 1:19 so we can look at the word public example? Well, you can read the verse on top again.
Matthew chapter 1, verse
19.
Then Joseph, her husband,
who she was already having sex with.
Who she was having sex with. Being a just man.
Mm-hmm.
And not willing to make her a public example.
He was a just man. He didn't want to make her a public example. Meaning what? Jacob, being a just man, didn't want to make Mary a public example because he didn't want to make Mary, he didn't want to cause Mary to be viewed as an adulteress and cause her to be put to death, knowing that she didn't commit adultery.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was a just man. He wasn't going to bring up a false accusation against her. Right. He wasn't going to present Mary as one who was an adulteress, which would result in Mary being made a public example because he was a just man.
Right.
He's not. I'm not going to bear false witness against her. I'm not going to make her a public example. She's pregnant before the wedding feast. People are going to see her pregnant and they're going to think that
she's a whore.
She's a whore. Because we didn't have a wedding feast. We didn't have a ceremony. We didn't go through the natural, we didn't go through our ancient customs. So people would see Mary pregnant, knowing that there was no feast, knowing that there was no wedding, knowing that there was no ceremony, and they would assume Mary to be a harlot.
Mm-hmm.
And had they assumed Mary to be a harlot, they would have brought Mary to the door of her father's house and they would have stoned her with stones till she died. But Joseph, being the just man, wasn't going to have Mary suffer the judgment of an adulteress. So he said, I'm not going to make her be a public example because she didn't do anything, the act of adultery. But what does it mean, public example?
It says, it's para di gamatizo.
Let me play it right here.
Yeah.
Strong's G, 3856, paradigmatizo. Paradigmatizo.
Paradigmatizo. What does it say?
To set forth as a public example, to make a public example of, make an example of, in a bad sense, to hold up to infamy.
When you hold someone up in infamy, you're saying that person is wicked. That person has a bad history. Go ahead.
Yeah, if infamy, evil reputation brought about by
evil
something.
Evil accusation. That's what would happen.
Right.
She made a public example of because those accusations would have been brought up against them. People would have believed it to be true.
Right.
Because had they had a wedding feast and they've been the sheet wasn't covered with the tokens of a virginity, they'd say, wait a minute, hold on, Joseph.
Right.
Hold on, Mary. They would assume that she was already having sex with somebody else.
Right.
That would have been what was assumed.
Mm-hmm.
But since that wasn't what occurred, Joseph knew that people saw her pregnant without it being a feast. They would assume that it being an adulteress and they would have tried to stone her to death. So Joseph said, I'm a just man. I'm not going to have Mary suffer the judgment of an adulteress knowing that she didn't commit adultery. I'm not going to lie to be a public example. Go ahead. It says more to that definition.
Okay. It says to expose public disgrace.
To expose to public disgrace. And what would that public disgrace be? Mm-hmm. Stone her to death in public.
Right.
He didn't want that to happen.
Right.
Because he knew she didn't commit adultery. So why would he go through all of that trouble? Because she was already pregnant.
Right, with his child.
With his child. She was already pregnant. Come on, man.
It says, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily.
Yeah, go that word away, because that's what he went to. A polluted side, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Let me get that real quick. Get it right here real quick. Play it.
Strong's G630. Apaluo. Apaluo.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It says to set free, to let go, dismiss.
He put her away privately. Meaning, he put her away. He dismissed her privately. Privately meaning secretly.
Mm-hmm.
So it says he set her free privately or secretly. We know he didn't actually divorce her.
Right.
Because there's no scriptures saying that.
Right.
He didn't actually divorce her. So if it says he put away privately or apaluo, it means he let her go privately or he dismissed her privately. What did he dismiss her from privately? Mm. He dismissed her from the presence of the public.
Mm-hmm. From being stoned.
Because had she been in the presence of the public looking pregnant, they would have said, wait a minute, hold on. This woman committed an act of adultery. They ain't had no wedding feast. They didn't go to the ceremony.
Right.
Had he had sex with her in the nuptial chamber, but was able to show tokens of a virginity, then it says she had to have been having sex with somebody else.
Mm-hmm. A petitioner.
In time, she was going to start showing.
Right. A petitioner to whom liberty to depart is given by decisive answer, a bid, depart, send away.
And like you were saying earlier, when you go to these definitions, these words in the Greek and in the Hebrew, it gives you multiple definitions, but you have to find the proper context and according to the scripture.
Right.
So if we already know before they came together, it's talking about a feast because that's the ancient custom. Just as when Jacob said, give me my wife that I may go in unto her, and he had a feast, and he went in unto her after the feast.
Mm-hmm.
You know that's the custom that Joseph and Mary were supposed to go through.
Right.
Because Joseph and Mary didn't have a feast first, in other words, didn't have a feast first, but she was already found pregnant. That means before they came together and had to win a feast, Joseph had already went in unto her. And being they already went unto her, and people had seen Mary pregnant, they would have assumed her an adulteress. And if they would have assumed her an adulteress, they would have wanted to make her a public example by stoning her to death in accordance to Deuteronomy 22nd chapter. But Joseph being just man wasn't going to have her go through that, knowing that she didn't commit the act of adultery. He wouldn't have her suffer a judgment that she wasn't worthy of. So he put her away privately. I mean, he put her away, he dismissed her from the public, for the public's presence, privately. He did it in secret. When nobody was knew what was going on.
Mm-hmm. Yes, as a captive, his bonds bid him depart to give him liberty and acquit of one accused of a crime to send him a liberty. There's none of these.
And this is what he's trying to say, use of divorce to dismiss from the house to repudiate the wife of a Greek or Roman may divorce her husband, But it's nowhere in the Bible to say he ever parted ways with Mary. Mm-hmm. No scripture. And the last definition is to send oneself away to depart. That's the best definition.
Right.
He put her away privately. Mm-hmm. Meaning he sends her away.
Right.
And the word there privately means secretly.
Right.
Come on, man.
Right.
This is obvious stuff here.
Yeah. And that's, and like we was building on, you, out of all the definitions here, you use the definition
best suit your agenda.
That best suits your agenda. And once again, the Bible was translated many times. Mm-hmm. The Bible was translated many times. And that's why the scriptures say to get the proper understanding of the Bible, you have to link precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, to understand what's going on in this in the scripture, you got to go back to what's written before. Because, mm-hmm. like the brother brung out, when you read later on in the chapter, in verse 23, this was all prophesied to happen. Mm-hmm. A young woman giving birth to a child, and his name was going to be Emmanuel. Mm-hmm. That's all prophesied. That's how we understand that this scripture ain't talking about a virgin birth. It's that plain and simple. The scripture is talking about a young woman, all right? Because virgin, which came from the Hebrew word ayalama, which means young woman. It doesn't mean a bathwala, which means virgin.
Exactly.
Not penetrated.
It means young woman of marriageable age. I'm ayalama.
Ayalama.
No?
All right. So yeah, let's go back to the video.
Yeah, let's go back to this clown.
Quiso dejarla secretamente.
To another translation, the Spanish translation of the Bible, and he's saying, see, he says he wanted to leave her secretly. Mm-hmm. Why he want to leave her secretly? Didn't the angel come to him?
Right.
Why would he want to leave her secretly?
Right.
Didn't that the angel in Matthew first chapter come to Joseph?
Right.
So why would he want to leave her secretly?
That's the verse coming up though.
No, I'm saying, but that's what he's alluding to.
Right.
That's what he's alluding to. Mm-hmm. Because we know the angel came to Joseph.
Right.
So saying that he wanted to leave her secretly would make no sense. Because mm-hmm. to say that he wanted to leave her secretly means that before the angel told him she was pregnant, so he assumed that he's like, wait a minute, I didn't have sex with her yet. Mm-hmm. Why is she pregnant? Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
That's the only reason why he wanted to leave her secretly, but we already know that's not true.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
I got you. Is a clown, man. I got a precept though, and it came to my mind.
Yeah, bring it up, man.
And a precept.
Come on now, man. He wanted to put her away. Mm-hmm. Why would he want to put her away?
Mm-hmm.
He already said he was a just man. And you, and according to the Bible, you can't act of adultery.
Right.
Then now your house shall say that? Because if you put a woman away, if you put a woman away, I mean, she didn't commit the act of adultery, you caused her to commit adultery. Because right. she's still actually married to you. So you're going to put away Mary and cause her to commit adultery, and then would you eventually lead her to become a public example?
Mm-hmm.
Come on, man.
This is Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 1. This is found in the Apocrypha, if brothers don't know. All right? Or the KJV 16 and 11 version. It says, Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 1. I myself also am a mortal man, like to all. And the offspring of him that was first made of the earth. And in my mother womb was fashioned to be flesh in the time of 10 months, being compacted in blood of the seed of man and the pleasure that came with sleep, which is sex. All right. And Solomon said that he came through the seed of man because that's just how birth operates. A man has to lay down with a woman in order for her to get pregnant.
Yeah.
It's common sense.
Yeah.
All right. And when I was born, I drew the comet in and fell upon the earth, which is of like nature. And the first voice which I uttered was crying, as all others do. And I was nursed and swaddled in clothes, and that with cares. For there is no king that had any other beginning of birth. And isn't Yahweh Shai king? Isn't who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ, known as King of Kings and Lords of Lords? He said, for there is no king that had any other beginning of birth.
There you go.
For all men have one entrance into life.
Other than Melchizedek. That's it.
Yeah.
The Bible clearly tells you he had no father or mother. Right. Oh, what about him? Melchizedek means king of righteousness.
Right, right.
You're going to say that, you know?
For all men have one entrance into life and the light going out. All right? Fucking clowns, man.
It's ridiculous, brother. House.
And so this guy made a comment on there that the woman can conceive seed through her ovum.
She can hold seed.
Exactly, you idiot. Do you know what the word ovum is? The word ovum is Latin for egg, you dummy.
And he clearly doesn't understand what the scriptures is talking about. Shows you that these dudes ain't on no level, man.
Yeah.
To sit there and believe that a woman has seed, you're out of your goddamn mind.
Yeah.
That a woman can produce without a man's seed, you're out of your goddamn mind.
Yeah.
So he pulled, despite their insults, the Bible does refer to women having seed. You err not understanding the scriptures. You err not knowing the scriptures. Because the Bible, what's the word you use? Patriotic?
Patrilineal?
Patrilineal. The Bible is a patrilineal
book.
The Most High deals with the man.
Yeah, everything goes through the lineage of the Father.
When you read, this whole argument gets shut down by just reading Matthew's, the genealogy of who the world ignorantly calls Jesus Christ. Because you don't see no women. Like the brother brung out earlier, the 12 sons of Jacob or the 12 sons of Israel, there is no tribe of Dinah. There's 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. Jacob had a daughter named Dinah. Where's the nation of Dinah at?
Yeah, with Dinahites.
Where's the Dinahites?
You got Ephraimites, you got Judahites, you got Manassites, Gadites, you got Reubenites, you got Asherites. You got all of these other ites. Where's the Dinahites?
Exactly.
There's no scripture on that.
Exactly. So he pulls out Hebrews 11:11. Let's get that.
Yeah.
You got it.
Yep. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 11.
Hold on, let me get that.
Okay.
Got it.
It's for the... It's the word seed. Well, you can read it.
Well, yeah, I'm going to read it, and then we're going to go into it.
Yeah.
It says, through Hebrews 11:11, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed.
Yeah, she received strength to conceive seed.
You look up the seed. First? Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Strong's G, 2602, Katabale. Katabale.
It says a throwing or laying down, the injection or depositing.
A throwing or laying down, because you know the ancient way. What was you saying earlier about the whole women used to squat in the ancient world?
Right, back old customs. I think basically everything before America, women were squatting.
They were doing that in Africa. That's why when you read the book of, what was that, what Solomon read?
Mm-hmm.
It said what? I fell upon the earth.
Right.
If he fell upon the earth, that his mother wasn't laying
on her back.
She wasn't on her back. She had to have been squatting.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
So instead of throwing down or casting down, she conceived seed, or she throw it down or cast it down when she was giving birth. That's when she was conceiving that child.
Mm-hmm. It says the injection or depositing of the viral semen in the womb.
See, of the viral that
women can't eject semen into themselves.
Yeah, they can't eject semen.
They can't deposit semen into themselves. So obviously this is talking about the man's seed. This is talking about the sperm of a man going into a woman's womb.
Exactly.
So when it referenced Sarah's seed, it's talking about Isaac.
Exactly.
No, Abraham. Abraham married Sarah.
Exactly.
So it's talking about Abraham's seed.
Exactly.
And when it's referencing...
Seed, and that seed was Isaac.
Which is Isaac.
Yeah.
You know? And when it referenced Rebekah's seed, that's talking about Isaac's seed. Mm-hmm. Because Isaac laid down with Rebekah. How is that so hard to understand? But which goes to show that goes back to that Roman Catholicism, paganism.
Madness
with Semiramis's, Tammuz,
Nimrod,
and the worshiping of the Queen of Heaven.
That's right.
They uphold the woman's vagina and birth.
As a form of worship.
As a god.
Yeah.
Which is all paganism. It has nothing to do with the scriptures.
So she conceived that seed. She was pregnant. And she gave birth, you know, and it says with the virile
semen in the womb.
You got that word virile, and then Google, you can look it up.
Since you have a traditionally masculine trace, especially to a marked degree, a characteristic or associated with men.
There you go, a characteristic associated with men. Therefore, she if it says in Hebrews 11:11. It's talking about a man impregnating a woman right there. So you go to Hebrews 11:11, and then you don't even know what you're talking about.
I want to look up ejected and deposited.
Yeah. It's giving you the medical definition. Probably going to have to go to a regular dictionary. They'll give you the hospital definition, though.
Yeah. To entry a place in the space. Man. The action of injecting.
Well, when something is injected, and something is going inside of it.
It's going in.
So you've got any other definition down there. Well, we already understand.
Yeah, we understand. It's like being put in.
Yeah. It's like if you take a needle and you put it, you inject somebody with something.
Yeah.
The way a man penetrates a woman and injects her with sperm.
Yeah.
Same process.
An active instance of forcing a fluid into a part of the body by using special needles, which is the rod.
Exactly.
All right?
Meaning a penis, all right?
Yeah.
Rod, what that supposed to mean?
Right. It said depositors. Let's look that up real fast. Yeah.
When something deposits, it's you depositing your check, you putting your check
inside
your account.
Mm-hmm. Something such as money that is entrusted for safekeeping, as in a bank conditioning of being deposited, funds on deposit with the broker. That means you're giving, mm-hmm. All right? Simple. But it's like, we got to go into this because it ain't simple.
Exactly.
We got to break down every word,
every
suffix, prefix.
Exactly.
Context, we got to break everything down because it's like you got niggas like this, which is a heathen, unlearned. They are niggas,
yeah.
All right? Unlearned people, so-called scholars and professors, breaking the scriptures down wrong.
That's right, brother.
And once again, this is like the scriptures say, pulling down a stronghold in every vain, in every false word that speaketh against the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
Back to Matthew's.
Oh, we're gonna read seed there. It was seed and
Yeah, we're gonna read it.
11:11. Where seed?
Through faith also, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed. And what does that mean, receive strength? Because Sarah couldn't have kids.
Yeah, she was an old woman.
She was an older woman.
She was like, I'm too old for that.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
But the Most High gave her the spirit to be able to have the child of have Abraham's seed and get pregnant. So it says through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, to bear a child.
Sarah was up in age.
Right.
She didn't think that she'd be able
to get pregnant.
To get pregnant because she was an old age. you know?
And was delivered of a child when she was past age. There you go.
And it said seed. You read the word seed there.
Yeah.
You got the word seed in the Greek.
Strong's G, 4690, sperma. Sperma.
Mm-hmm.
You go right down. Now, this is a clear example of how you got a lot of definitions, but you got to go to the right one.
Right.
Right there. Number. Go ahead.
Nah, yeah, because from which a plant germinates, the seed, i.e. the grain or kernel. Is this talking about an actual seed from a plant? Seed from a crop? Yeah. Seed from a flower, a fruit? No, it's not. Which contains within itself the germ of the future plants. Going all the way down to the second definition, it says, oh, this is a metaphor, a seed, i.e. residue, few survivors, reserve. Is that talking about that? No. The sperm, it says the semen, viral.
Viral.
Yeah. The product of the semen, seed, children, offspring, progeny, family, tribe, posterity. All right?
And then the last one is wrong. Of divine energy of the Holy Spirit. That's a damn lie.
Right.
The scriptures clearly tell you in the book of, what's that, 1 Corinthians 15, there's a glory of the one glory of men and another glory of angels.
Right.
So angels don't eat or drink. Angels don't have sex. Right. Angels don't have sex in the heavens. Okay, so that's a completely wrong definition. You got to go with the context of the scripture. And according to the context of the scripture, it's talking about actual seed that's put into a woman from a man. And the word seed goes back to the Greek word sperma. You move the A from sperma, you get the word sperm.
Sperm.
That simple, man. This guy's a knucklehead.
Genesis 24 and 60.
Yeah. So what scripture you went to?
Genesis chapter 24, verse 60. And they blessed Rebekah and said unto her, thou art our sister, be thou the mother of thousands and of millions, and let thy seed possess the gate of those which hate them. Now you look up this word seed. It says, and let thy seeds possess the gate. This is Zarai. The first character is a Za, the second character is a Ra, the last character is a I. Zarai. Alright? Seed, sowing, offspring, a sowing, a seed. Semen, veril, offspring, the same word, the same definition.
Same thing in the book of Hebrews 11.
Hebrews
same
11. Thing. Same
body,
thing.
The only thing about it is Hebrew. Hebrew. The definitions are the same.
So this ain't talking about Rebecca and Sarah having seeds, exactly. Themselves.
Themselves. That's that ancient Greek stuff they call it parthenogenesis, which is the ability of a woman to basically be fertilized without sperm.
Yeah, this ain't talking about no damn bottling.
Exactly, no damn bottling.
Your bottling, go ahead.
Yeah, I remember that. So it ain't talking about that. Parthenogenesis is reproduction by of an ovum without fertilization. That's not scriptural.
Thank you. Which that's not even talking about that. He doesn't understand. That's a whole nother show.
Yeah.
You see, we already 50 minutes in.
God damn.
That's going to be a whole nother 2 hours just talking about these scriptures.
And we thought it was going to be 35, 40 minutes.
Right.
But we almost done.
Yeah, we almost done through the spirit, but that's not talking about. Beyond that, there's Genesis 3:15, which for the conflict between the seed of the serpent, which is Esau, Edom, the so-called Caucasian race.
Exactly.
All right? They're the seeds of the serpent because they are the physical counterpart of the spiritual demon Satan. Mm-hmm. All right? That serpent was in reference to the so-called white man.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And the seed of Eve, once again, the seed that Adam put in Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Eve doesn't have seed on her own.
That's why Genesis 4:1 said Adam knew his wife and she conceived. Adam knew his wife Eve and she bare a son.
Thank you.
So on and so forth.
It was so hard to be honest. Women cannot have kids without a man injecting their semen into them.
Like you would think you would learn. This is like seventh grade stuff.
Yeah.
Tell you the truth, it's like you learning something in health class in 7th grade.
The first sex ed class or whatever. First health class. Women does not produce seed on their own. It's that simple. That prefigures Revelations 12 and 17, which speaks on the dragon who makes war with the woman's seed. The dragon, which in reference to the Roman Empire, mm-hmm. all right, which was ruled by Esau, Edom, the so-called Caucasian race.
Which in this time is NATO, EU, America is a part of that, you know?
Who would make war with the woman seed. Once again, that's all metaphoric speech, mm-hmm. figurative speech. The woman is in reference to the nation of Israel. When you read, what's that, the book of Isaiah chapter 6, verse 2? Jeremiah 62.
Israel to a comely and delicate woman?
Israel was likened onto a comely and delicate woman. So that seed is talking about the nation of Israel, all right? Like I said, that's a whole nother show, yeah. A whole bunch of precepts that links what we're saying. But we're going to continue on with this topic. At this point, Tahar and this group might wish to object that in those verses, seed is a metaphorical reference to offspring. It's not metaphorical.
Yeah, it's not.
It's literal.
That's literal, like, literal in regards to she actually conceived seed, but it was the man seed.
Man seed. Man sperm.
Man sperm. You know what I'm saying? It's that simple. But now, so wait a minute. The brother just said metaphorical a couple seconds ago. He was saying metaphorical in regards to the woman not referencing an actual woman, somebody right. Israel. That's right. What he was talking about.
Right. So, and that just goes, the spirit is not dealing. You don't know when it's literal and when it's metaphorical. Where it's parabolic, it wasn't given unto you to understand those things. Yeah. That's why you confuse. It's a stumbling block onto you. It's a stumbling block onto you. You can't decipher when it's literal, when it's figurative, and when it's literal and when it's figurative. Yeah. Parabolic.
Yeah.
You can't decipher.
Because if it says Sarah conceived seed and he was 11, it's literally talking about Sarah giving birth to a son, giving birth to Isaac. Which that seed was put in her from Abraham. Like, come on, man. It was said Rebecca conceived seed. It's about the seed that was put in Rebecca from Isaac. Come on, dude. That's simple. And that seed that was going to rule over millions and so on and so forth was from my Israel. The rule of possess the gates of his enemies to my Israel. Because I don't know if we mentioned that. Mm-hmm. It's from my Israel, the Israelites.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Which that was going to come from who? Jacob, who was Isaac's son.
We cover that. What does Matthew's 1:18 through 20? We cover that. Let me see something. Just to make sure.
Yeah, we covered that. That's when it says, before they come together and all of that. 1:18, right?
Yeah, we covered that.
We covered that.
In what sense is Yahweh Shai the seed of David? We covered that as well. Because when you look up the word seed, real quick, let's get that.
Okay.
Romans, which is going to be the same.
Yeah.
The word seed.
We didn't even look at it. We just know it's going to be the same thing.
Exactly. Romans 1, and what's that, 4? Or Romans 1 and 8?
Let me see.
3.
Yep.
Romans chapter 1, verse 3. Concerning his son, Yahweh Shai, Mashiach, or Jesus Christ as you see it, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, it according to the flesh. So how is that according to the flesh?
There you go.
What's the word seed there? Let's see. Which we know is the same, but this is for the edification.
Strong's G4690, sperma. Sperma.
There you go. Same definition. Same exact thing.
Same Strong's. Same definitions that we read in Hebrews 11:11.
Yep.
Which related to Genesis 24 and 60.
Mm-hmm.
It says, concerning Yahweh Shah, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh. How is it according to the flesh? Because it was the actual lineage, the actual line, the gene that came from David. That's why Matthew's 1, verse 1, all the way down to 18, it spoke about the genealogy of who the world ignorantly called Jesus Christ. Really? And they was all men.
That's right. Now, can you get Revelation 20:16? This is Revelation 27th chapter.
So all it talks about was the seed of man, the seed of man. And he begot this person, he begot that person. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. I, Yahweh Shai.
This is Yahweh Shai speaking himself. This is the man himself. It's him talking.
Has sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David.
He said it himself. He said it himself.
That's right.
Why he didn't say Mary?
Right.
Since now Mary, right. now that.
Nah, that's it.
Now Mary's a righteous woman.
Yeah.
We're not shunning Mary.
No.
That's the Lord's mother. She's a righteous woman. Yeah. But she's not over no man.
No.
She was, the scriptures call her, she was highly favored.
She was highly favored.
She was blessed and highly favored among women to be the mother of the son of Yahweh Shai.
Yeah.
That's an honorable thing.
That is.
You know, and she was a black woman. She was an Israelite woman.
She is a so-called black woman, yeah.
But guess what? He comes from the root and offspring of David.
Right.
And that word there
look for, up offspring.
Yep. Look, like we go all the way to root. You can go all the way to where it's offspring?
Yeah.
I was gonna offspring first. Okay.
Strong's G 1085. Genos.
Kindred, offspring, family, stock, tribe, nation, i.e. nationality or descendant from a particular people.
Come on.
The aggregate of many individuals of the same nature, kind, sort. So it says descent from a particular people. Who's that descent from? David.
Mm-hmm.
You got that word, root. Oh, you gonna look it up?
Yeah, I just wanted to look up offspring real fast.
Right. Because the offspring is to spring off or something.
Mm-hmm.
When something is springing, it's shooting off of something.
A person's child or children. That's it.
We even got to go to etymology.
Yeah. You said root?
Yeah, root.
Strong's G, 4491. Hridza.
A root. That which... like a root springs from a root, a sprout, shoot, metaphorically, offspring, progeny. So here's the progeny of David. What does the word progeny mean? Progeny means offspring or children. There you go.
Mm-hmm.
You even got to go nothing else from
there. Yeah.
And one more negative verse is, what else was that? That the only word that words us in that passage?
Yeah, and that's it, bro.
Yeah. Defense reversal, I guess.
It says, these things in the churches, I am the root and the offspring of David.
There you go.
And the bright morning star.
So you can go back to that. Just...
began to be about 30 years of age, being as was supposed the son of Joseph.
Being as it was supposed the son of Joseph. Now let the cameraman look at that, man. If you know anything about a parenthesis, that's what's right there. That's an afterthought. That they put that in there. That's not the original scripture. Anytime you see that parenthesis, that's not a part of the scriptures. All right?
Notice that Jahar did not provide any evidence that this is not part of the original Greek text. Rather, he only asserted such. Was he hoping others would just take his word for it? Or is he basing his argument entirely upon the punctuation in the KJV. Now, let's look that word. Let's look up parentheses. Let's see if what apostles are saying is true.
Yeah. Look at the word parentheses real quick. Look at the word parentheses on Google. You looking up on your thing?
Yeah.
Look at the word parentheses on Google. It says Greek parentheni, late Latin parenthesis, mid-16th century. Mid-16th century via late Latin from Greek. From parentheni, put in beside. So the parentheses literally means to put in beside. You're putting in something beside something that's already there.
Mm-hmm.
And you look at the definition. It says parentheses, noun. It says a word, clause. It says a word, clause, or sentence inserted
mm-hmm.
as an explanation or afterthought
mm-hmm.
into a passage that is grammatically complete without it. In writing, usually marked off by curved brackets, dashes, or commas. So let's break that down. A word, clause, or sentence inserted as an explanation or afterthought into a passage. So it's inserted as an afterthought. Mm-hmm. Why is it inserted as an afterthought? Because they actually thought that Yahweh Shai was not the actual son of Joseph.
Right.
So they saw it was supposed that he mm-hmm. was his son. So that was added there as an afterthought. Mm-hmm. Or else, why would the parentheses even be there?
Right.
Why would the parentheses even be there?
Right.
Why would it be there? All over Matthew, the first chapter, you're not going to find parentheses there.
Mm-hmm.
Why is the parentheses there in the book of Luke? Where in the Greek you going to find the parentheses there?
Mm-hmm.
And even if you go in the Greek, let's see somehow you find parentheses in the Greek.
Right.
We know parentheses literally means to put in beside. It means it was still put in beside whatever was written.
Mm-hmm.
Which therefore means it was an afterthought.
Mm-hmm.
If I say, if I wrote a story and I said his friend went to the store and he didn't come back in an hour, and it says, then he went to the store, and parentheses I put, for he was looking for his friend.
Right.
I'm adding that there as an afterthought.
Right.
I'm putting it in beside what's already written there.
Right.
So it says, as was supposed, because it was put in beside the scripture itself.
Right.
So now we can go to that scripture, Luke 3 and 23, mm-hmm. and don't even say what's in parentheses, but read the scripture mm-hmm. and see what it says.
The book of Luke, chapter 3, verse 23. And Yahweh Shai himself began to be about 50 years of age.
30.
It's a lot. And Yahweh Shai himself began to be about 30 years of age, being the son of Joseph, which was the son of Heli.
So, there you go.
Simple.
That means that was added there as an afterthought.
Right.
Which means that wasn't originally there. That was put in beside there. So, when you read the passage, read it, but don't even say what's in parentheses. And if you notice, the scripture is still clear.
Mm-hmm. Being the son of Joseph.
Being the son of Joseph. It's still clearly written. Mm-hmm. Comes right through. And it says, a word, clause, or sentence inserted as an explanation or afterthought into a passage that is grammatically complete without it. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, a passage that is grammatically complete without it. So, the passage is already grammatically complete.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, there was no need to put that there.
Mm-hmm. Cut.
That's a cut. So the apostle Hall, no, he talk mm-hmm. like you guys. These are men that have been doing this for decades. You're not just gonna pop up mm-hmm. and then you're gonna tell them that they're wrong.
Mhm. I was thinking of something else.
Even growing up, I always read that. Whenever I read something in parentheses, I always noticed that even if you don't read what's in parentheses, the statement still makes sense.
Mhm. This is Luke. This is St. John, chapter 6, verse 42. And they said, is not this Yahweh Shai, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? So the people knew who the hell Yahweh Shai's father was.
Mm-hmm.
They knew who his father was. They knew who his mother was. And like we just read, it said Joseph, his father, in Luke.